Welcome back to Let's Play Torment to Tides of Numenera. I'm the RPG chick. Now running version 1.1.0. Now with this version, there's a new companion called who unfortunately I don't believe we can find. He's back in Sega's Cliffs. And I'm not sure if we can even get back to Sega's Cliffs. So, unfortunately, yeah, I'd have to literally play everything over again, and I really don't have time to be doing that with my busy schedule here. So, but there are some changes. Other changes. There's a Voluminous Codex, and some changes to the UI and such. The inventory screens or something like that. Now, as far as when the,
I'd take a nap if that wasn't even more boring.
Oh, shush you. When the game is over, I'll put up meeting and all the, you know, initial dialogue and such as, like, an extra bonus episode. But I'm not gonna be running through the whole game again with him. Regrettable. It's too bad they didn't come out with the expansion or update sooner. So, I was trying to see if anything is different here. Not sure. There's the Codex, though. So we'll be reading through that this episode. Or at least part of it. I don't know how long it is. If it's anything like codexes in other games, it'll be quite long. So, yeah, I'm not sure. Maybe they're all these abilities or in tiers now? Not sure if I remember it being like that. Here's the quest. This is what we're going to be doing next in the story. Okay, cool. We got companions, characters, locations, creatures, and factions and cults. So anyway, of course, starting with characters. Elegern. Yeah, I kind of wished I had switched out Calistige and, you know, traveled with him for a little bit and then come back to her. Maybe another bonus episode, right? Allegern and Anyway, a dour explorer and former Aeon priest with living, intricately designed tattoos that writhe across his forearms, Allegern thinks you might be the changing god. He is watching you closely. Or he was. He can pull the tattoos from his arm as if they were wires under his skin, using them in battle to defend himself and his companions. He wears a faded gray duster that buttons from the neck down to the waist, has a number of pockets, bulging with small pieces of equipment. Calistige. Cool, I love this portrait of her. Yeah, I love that we actually have portraits. We can see what they... Well, we already know what they look like, right? But this is more detailed. Zoomed out. You can see more. Calistige is a woman whose consciousness has fractured itself through the dimensions. Her echoes shimmer through multiple realities. She refers to these alternative shadows as her sisters. Double quotes, huh? On each side. Or double quotes, actually. She's a brilliant nano, and she seems to want something from you. Calistige wears a bright wardrobe of oranges and reds as if she were on fire. Her long metallic hair shimmers. She wears earrings, necklaces, bracelets, anklets, and belts of varying materials and workmanship. Eritus. A brash glaive, his intellect dimmed by the brilliant glow that surrounds him, Eritus is always ready for adventure. The more dangerous, the better. and he's overjoyed to have you along to support him. Eretus is an unusually attractive young man, and his guiding star is to have as much excitement in his life as possible. Eretus doesn't plan, he doesn't do tactics, and he doesn't like thinking things through, because really, what has that ever done for anyone anyway? Point him toward a catastrophe and let him go. And if no catastrophe exists, time to create one. Matt Keena. Your cast-off sister is an albino assassin feared across the Sagus Protectorate. They call her the White Death. She is a calculating jack-of-all-trades with a huge intellect and enormous potential. This is another one we didn't bring with us. Rin. Aww. I still feel terrible about Rin. You found Rin hiding from slavers in a pile of rubbish in Cliff's Edge. The poor child has a clearly visible head wound, and she says she came from another world. She claims to talk to gods and carries their totems in her pouch. Is she insane, or does she truly hold some latent power? Whatever her truth, she looks to you for her survival. That sucks for her. From another world, or from another town? Why knows that she came from some other town here? On this world, I thought. The last cast-off. You are the last cast-off, a discarded shell built to hold the consciousness of the changing god, a man obsessed with cheating death. You awoke within the dark fathom of your own mind after plummeting from orbit towards Sagus Cliffs. It is a miracle that you managed to survive, and as the sorrow draws closer to you, you may not survive much longer. So here's the male version of the last cast-off. Tybier. I'm surprised there's not more to say about Tybier. A charming rogue, a former mercenary, and an admitted confidence man, but not necessarily the bravest. He's quick with a blade, faster with his tongue, and prefers to lead from behind. Sounds rather suggestive. Characters. Adiris, who is now before us. The cast-offs of Mila Vest are led by a woman named Adiris, a visionary who keeps the peace, forcing the cast-offs to focus on finding ways to fight the sorrow. Adiris possesses an uncanny beauty. She is a mother and guide to the cast-offs with a kind and caring demeanor, but a mortal threat to anyone who threatens the cast-off sanctuary. Barakal Bruna. A warrior of iron will and exceptional self-control, Barakal is of indeterminate gender and is muscular, slim, and tall. An unyielding foe, faithful ally, and deadly in battle, Barakal has been a squad leader and commando in the 1st Militia for years and has been integral in many successful operations. Castoff. You know what? Doesn't this music sound loud? Codex, see? Oh, that brings us to character sheet. Cast-off. Those who have been birthed by the changing gods' abandonment are known as cast-offs. Though it's speculated that a few hundred or more are scattered throughout Sagus Cliffs and the wider Protectorate, no one knows how many there are. This one looks messed up. Foreman. Right, those foremen, they were pretty cool. Residing in the Underbelly's manufactory are three large constructs. Millennia ago, these foremen built and maintained massive starships. Though they can no longer move, they are still able to direct the efforts of human laborers. The foremen are constantly devising better ways to fabricate materials and rework the Numenera to benefit Sagus Cliffs. Jibra. The Jibra Nykul. The children of Nykul are the native inhabitants of the oasis of Emeradulios. They are a race of aquatic humanoids, varying widely in appearance. They believe that this physical diversity is a gift from their god. They may have scales, hide, or shells, flippers or legs, claws or fingers. The Jibra communicate telepathically in a language they called Kalash Nykul, the word of Nykul. They frequently speak the truth as well, for they believe in maintaining relationships with the world outside their watery bubble. Water ships. That sounds interesting. Imbitu. Imbitu is the elderly leader of the Dendra or Her chapter in Sega's Clefts. Friendly and cunning, Imbitu is devoted to keeping human knowledge from the grasp of the great Queen Sarlavan, the Lady of Maggots, who waits on the other side of death to devour the minds of those who pass on. Imbitu has consumed the corpses of countless leaders and Skylarks, so he possesses the experience of many lifetimes. Inifier, right, we just defeated. Inifier is one of your cast-off siblings, born in a dimension of horror. He is almost skeletal in appearance and utterly mad. He would be harmless if it were not for the cultists who venerate him as the living portal to the Endless Gate. Levy. The constables of Sega's Clefts are called Levies, an army of nearly identical manufactured humanoids who wear the silver indigo colors of the city. It's clear from the briefest of glances that Levies are not quite human. Their features are plain, forgettable, and generic. Their eyes too large, their smiles too firmly fixed on their faces. Though their manner is typically friendly, most people find them unsettling and try to avoid interacting with them. Actually, there is something. I don't think we can see it. On our own screen. But I remember now. It'll say whether someone likes you or not. Sure. Where would it say that? Stat pulls, effort, defense. I mean, for all I know, I'm like looking right at this thing. It's supposed to say whether, you know, how these characters feel about you. I think if it would be anywhere, it would be in the character sheet. I don't remember all this here. Plus 5 health at tier 1. Seems to go into more detail. You know, I don't know. She says she adores me. Yeah, I don't know. Sorry, guys.
Yes?
Alright. I might be missing it, but... These are, of course, just my quests. Yeah, it's annoying because I do want to see. I mean, I'm sure I'm like good standing with all of them, but kind of curious to see. All right, well, let's continue with the Codex. Maybe I'll look that up. Maybe I'll find some way to do it. Anyway, we were on Levy, so now Melmoth Leviarm. Leviosa. Melmoth Leviarm is the leader of the cannibalistic Dendra O'Hur and is devoted to the idea of retaining knowledge in all its forms. He wears tattered leather robes draped with a profusion of wires and tubes. He has piercing eyes set amidst a hideously scarred face, and he wears tattered robes. Yet you said that. With countless wires and tubes snaking from every corner of his body. Okay, this whole sentence can be taken out. Melmoth is a master of the tides, having spent his life trying to understand their function. He does not suffer fools lightly. This music is really annoying. Why is it so loud? 25% music volume. It is getting lower, right? I'll keep it on 25%. Just want to make sure you guys can hear me. Maybe it doesn't apply to when you're in menus like this. Mutant. Mutants are humans whose bodies or minds are radically different from the norm. Sometimes these differences are due to the natural forces of evolution, and sometimes they are the result of an unnatural manipulation. In the Ninth World, mutants often band together, as those with hideous deformities may face violence and derision. While many mutants are outcasts, others are revered for the powers that their mutations confer upon them. Yes. The X-Men. Paj Reckon. As commander of the First Militia, your sibling Paj is devoted to the struggle against the changing god. She now carries the First Mantle and has devoted centuries of her life to overthrowing your sire. Paj is utterly committed to the survival of the castoffs, and she has little patience for those who support the changing god, who she says seeks to kill all of your kind. Reflection. When a person you meet in the world has made a strong enough impression, a reflection of that person is born within the calm of your mind. These are often distorted echoes of their true selves, but they might still hold secrets or untapped power. Sega's townsperson. The people of Sega's Cliffs are laborers, merchants, artisans, entertainers, bureaucrats, vagrants, and criminals. Many are descended from the first people who settled here almost 1,000 years ago. They are quite accustomed to the weird artifacts that are scattered about their city, but they're wise enough to avoid them. At least, most of them are. Seria. Right, you found this young woman's corpse beneath the wreckage of a collapsed house in Cliff's Edge. When you first saw her, she dragged you into the labyrinth of your mind, where she appeared as the shadowy outline of a woman. You found a puzzle box that was precious to her in life, allowing her to manifest as a ghost of her former self. But she is still just a memory. A reflection that belonged to another castoff. Silver Orphan. Despite their name, Silver Orphans have little in common with helpless waifs. They are roughly the size of a full-grown human, with shimmering silver alloy skin. They wander the Ninth World, seeking news of machine intelligences for some inexplicable reasons of their own. Silver Orphans cannot speak, so they typically communicate through gestures and drawings. It's the Geth. They're gonna rise up against the organics. Sir Arthur Torrain is a traveler and one of the foremost experts on the Numenera. At least, that's what he says. He makes his home in the Steadfast and has one of the most extensive libraries about the Numenera in the known world. He is always on the move, seeking to build upon his existing knowledge. Right, we found them in the Fifth Eye Tavern, I believe was the name. Slave Families. For centuries, the Slave Families have ruled Sega's Cliffs. They claim to be descended from the slaves who followed Chilla the Great to victory over the great bosses of the city. The leaders of each family form the governing council of the city, which seems simultaneously competent and disinterested in the affairs of the common people. Most members of the council are content to wield power without drawing attention to themselves. But every rule has its exceptions. One such exception is Yars Vuntgen, a fat, yellow-skinned aristocrat who fancies himself a rabble-rouser. Yeah, I don't like him very much. The Chalcedon. The Chalcedon is commander of the Changing God's forces in the Endless Battle. He is devoted to your creator, believing that the Changing God has a plan that will stop the sorrow for good. He is a dangerous foe and a brilliant tactician. The Changing God. The landscape, culture, and history of Sega's Cliffs have been changed or shaped in innumerable ways by the Changing God. At one point, in a distant past, he was a respected researcher and scientist, albeit flawed and selfish. But unlike most mere humans, the Changing God is not confined to a single lifetime. For centuries, the Changing God has continued his existence by transferring his consciousness into bodies of his own creation, casting off the many vessels that have held his mind. He has moved from life to life, whether to avoid pain, injury, or death, or to seek new sensations and experiences. What he didn't realize, at first, was that the bodies he left behind, though often left severely damaged, were not empty. Each time he tore his mind from one of these husks, a new consciousness was born inside, a new person with their own thoughts and dreams. I'm surprised this codex isn't longer, actually. I mean, when you compare it to, like, any Mass Effect game codex, it's rather short. The Spectre. A fragment of your imagination, the Spectre manifests himself in the calm. He is a handsome, affable man, or at least would be, if he weren't also a wispy blue psionic ghost. He drew power from the other memories that were in your mind to summon you back to consciousness, activating your body's healing abilities when you fell from the sky. He is a valuable friend, of sorts, and a font of information. Vargellon. These humanoid creatures are tall and gaunt, with a violent red tint to their flesh. Their eyes are contralateral and bulging, and a tall crest surmounts their head. They are often described by humans as cold and unemotional. Locations, creatures, factions. Yeah. Buried Crossroads. Beneath the crag of Sega's Cliffs, far below the level of human habitation, is a void in the rock. In the remote past, this place was a crossroads in some predecessor city, built by alien hands. More recently, the Changing God seems to have discovered this place and turned it into a secret refuge or laboratory. Inexplicably, the chamber is filled with breathable air, probably supplied by one of the Changing God's devices. Caravanserai. The highest peak of Sega's Cliff serves as a mooring point for airships of all varieties, serving those who wish to avoid the dangerous overland journey to the oasis of Emrajolios, the Valley of Dead Heroes, the City of Haref, or more distant destinations. A woman named Tranquility operates a hostel here for those who need a place to rest their heads. Cave of Last Words. For hundreds of years, the Cave of Last Words was a thieves' bolt hole, a place for the criminal element to hide from the law. It was also the site of countless suicides, where desperate people spent their last moments before throwing themselves into the sea. A great many of them chose to leave their final thoughts on the walls, words of despair, introspection, and rage. The cave has, of late, been your sister Matkina's home as she sank deeper and deeper into paranoia and dementia. Circus Minor. One of the prime markets in Sega's Cliffs, Circus Minor plays host to all manner of itinerant merchants and city spectacles. At its heart stands the clock, the machine once said to have unmoored the city in time during an invasion. All manner of public events happen here, traveling religious rivals, executions, performances, and more. It sits near the bottom of the city, very near the Reef of Fallen Worlds. Sorry about that, I have to fix that. Cliff's Edge. This tough neighborhood sits along one of the more exposed faces of Sega's cliffs. Sagging houses line the steep road, some along the cliff itself, where the ground is slowly crumbling away beneath them. This area is home to lower-class citizens, as well as merchants, beggars, and grifters. It also features a chirurgical parlor and the Fifth Eye Tavern. I was right. Too bad I never got to use this chirurgical parlor. Endless Battle. Centuries ago, the Changing God and his cast-offs worked together against the Sorrow. He and the first cast-off were especially close, until the day when a disagreement poisoned their relationship. The disagreement became an argument, which became a struggle, which became a battle and then a war. The cast-offs chose sides, devoting their tremendous powers and talents to bloodshed. Some sided with the Changing God, believing that he had a plan to stop the Sorrow's genocide, or from a loyalty to the man responsible for their creation. Oops. Others sided with the first, believing that she had their best interests at heart against a fundamentally selfish creator. It's the longest entry yet. The two sides fought with all the weapons at their disposal, always to a draw, until the Changing God's armies suddenly began to suffer defeat after defeat. He discovered that his weapons were worthless, for the first had found the Reconciler of Truth, a device that could collapse multiple realities. He sought, and found, a counter in Heaven's Rejoinder, and the overlapping realities of their effects have torn time in the battlefield, parallel truths rolling and twining around each other. Really? The Reconciler of Truth and the Heaven's Rejoinder. A century ago, the first sought to end the battle and strike the decisive blow against one of the Changing God's mercenary companies, the Sand Knights. The Lieutenant Padge Reckon was charged with leading an assault on one of the Sand Knights' fortresses, and she gained entry just as the first was torn apart in a coruscation of energies. Reckon did not know the first had been destroyed, and used the Reconciler to snap the realities together, maintaining victory over the Sand Knights. By the time Reckon learned of the first's death, the first was irrevocably lost. The battle continues to divide the cast-off community, and mercenaries still flock to the battlefield, but the Changing God has moved on. So this is a location? Endless Battle is a location. It's weird. Government Square. The Council of Sega's Cliffs meets on the sun-swept square at the top of the crag, overlooking the broad waters of Garavia Sound. Enormous synth slabs pave the square, and the tips of ancient spacefaring vessels protrude from the ground, now repurposed as public buildings. The Order of Truth maintains its small, independent headquarters inside one of the starships, and emissaries from strange places meet in the Red Thicket, where their words cannot be overheard. Milavest. Milavest is a refuge from the Sorrow, a hidden sanctuary for cast-offs alone, created by the Changing God and the first cast-off. Shields cast by generators from a long-dead world hide it from prying eyes. The only law in Milavest is peace, and in its verdant air, cast-offs can focus on ways to stop the Sorrow forever. Yes, this is our current location. Reef of Fallen Worlds. Nowhere is the evidence of ancient civilizations more apparent than in the Reef of Fallen Worlds. In one section of the harbor, forgotten structures and abandoned war automatons break the surface of the water. This is prime pick for brave scavengers, but the place hides significant dangers for the unwary and the unlucky. Sega's Cliffs. Sega's Cliffs is one of the oldest human cities in Greater Garavia, built upon the ruins of more ancient metropolises. It occupies the headland overlooking Garavia Sound, with switchbacks and cutouts in the bluffs creating broad avenues that wind down to the harbors. Humanity has filled the old streets with their own ramshackle constructions, building wherever they can find a place to stake their claim. Strange towers and remnants of lost worlds pock the city here and there, and old machines still hum in the artificial caverns beneath the city. It is in these caverns that you see the city's true geological strata, the detritus of forgotten times. Some neighborhoods close to the cliff's edges are in danger of falling into the bay below. Every year, the city loses a little ground and a few more lives. Once the heart of the Sega's protectorate, the city's fortunes have slipped, its territory shrinking to a small pocket of land surrounding the city. The Beyond. The people of Steadfast call the lands outside their kingdoms the Beyond, but what they really mean are the lands west of the Clock of Kala, north of the Southern Wall, and south of this Sicilian jungle. The communities of these places have their own laws, living independently of the Amber Pope. Right. The Endless Gate. The Ninth World contains realms of wonder and beauty, and places of utter mind-destroying horror. The Endless Gate is one such place, a doorway that leads to a being of infinite hunger. Those with great psychic potential draw its attention. One such is the cast-off Inifir, abandoned in the Endless Gate, and his travails have brought him worshippers who venerate the gate's power. The children of the Endless Gate seek to liberate their hellish master in exchange for a sliver of its unfathomable power. The Fifth Eye. The Fifth Eye is an abandoned pumping station from a prior world, now used as a tavern by the people of Sagus Cliffs. Pipes lead deep underground, pumping a variety of fluids into the tavern. No one knows what the fluids are, but after some experimentation, they've learned which ones are relatively harmless and capable of intoxicating people. Veterans of countless psychic wars share ownership of the Fifth Eye, and they remain here at all hours. Something about the Fifth Eye architecture serves to drown out the constant mental noise of the city. Their shared mental strength attracts strange beings from across the universe. The Labyrinth. Your mind is a strange place. The changing god created some sort of psychic home for himself, a structure to contain his memories and consciousness. Reflections of people you once knew stand in the calm of the center of your mind, and fathoms below hide secrets and powers that your body once knew how to harness. Further exploration seems warranted, especially because the sorrow has infected you with its fragments. The Necropolis. The countless dead of innumerable worlds find their eternal repose in the honeycomb cells of the necropolis. Each civilization comes here through some strange compulsion, using the vast storage of the enormous cavern beneath the valley to preserve the memories of their ancient companions, or compatriots, rather. No doubt one could spend years exploring the vaults. Yeah, I don't really want to spend years exploring the vaults. The Ninth World. The Ninth World is Earth, a world that has seen massive civilizations rise and fall over the course of 2 billion years since sentient life first arose. Civilizations that could rekindle a dying sun, seed the atmosphere with nanomachines, shape the continents themselves into a massive mega-continent, become the seat of a vast interstellar empire, or make the fundamental forces of physics, their playthings. Is that all we did? Do we have one giant continent now? The Steadfast. Far to the west of Sagus Cliffs, past the trackless wastes and the Clock of Kala, the nine nations of the Steadfast form a nucleus of civilizations centered around the Amber Papacy, the core of the Order of Truth. The nine kingdoms of the Steadfast are Navarine, Malave, Gan, Thamor, Draolis, Malevic, Anshuin, Escobal, and the Pytherian Empire. While the Steadfast is settled and civilized, it is still a dangerous place. Isolated communities are still threatened, and travel is risky. Underbelly. Far below the great ships that dominate Government Square lies the Underbelly, a series of caverns cut from the compressed detritus of millennia. Per its name and reputation, the dregs of society congregate in the gloom. Mutants, the desperately poor, the cannibalistic Dendra or her, and other outcasts. The Stika can also be found here, digging and tunneling through the Underbelly's stone caverns. Valley of Dead Heroes. Northeast of Sagus Cliffs, a pair of mountain ranges surrounds the Valley of Dead Heroes. The valley is utterly lifeless, but is filled with shrines, statues, and cenotaphs. Many of these monuments were constructed by hands dead for millennia. Oddly, no corpses are buried in the valley. They are entombed in the necropolis, which lies directly beneath the valley floor. Creatures. Abacus. These trans-dimensional entities look like shadowy reflections of an angular, toothy humanoid, and the common folk believe them to be ghosts. They phase in and out of reality at will, and they seek sources of transdimensional energy to feed upon. Beyond that, their motives are uncertain. Yeah, I fought those things at the crossroads. I need a drink, hold on. Nycthemeron is a hovering biomechanical monstrosity. Its squid-like body mounted atop a hovering orb, lasers and scalpels at its tentacles' tips. During the day, it is a creature of rage and hate. At night, it is calm and rational. Two explorers captured a Nycthemeron, displaying it in a cage of energy in Circus Minor. I was never able to successfully finish that quest. I didn't want to. I wanted to let it free, or talk to it at night. I didn't want to mess with it. Peerless. The machine intelligence known as Peerless is more like a virus, installing copies of itself in other machines. These machines become Peerless drones, bloodthirsty and insane, and everyone is convinced that it is the original Peerless. No one knows where the true source of the Peerless drones can be found. I have fought them too. Stykus. Styka are large insectoid creatures. They are both organic and metallic, using their powerful digging claws to tunnel through rock. This activity generates piezoelectric energy that they feed upon. Styka hatch from eggs and dig death tunnels when they are ready to die. They communicate via gestures, clicks, and whistles, and a complex pheromonal language. The Sorrow. The Sorrow is an ancient horror that hunts the changing god and all his creations, namely, the castoffs. When you woke deep in the labyrinth of your mind, you felt the Sorrow's inexorable pressure as you rebuilt your memories. When you emerged into the calm and spoke to the specter, the Sorrow ripped its way into your mind and spilled its fragments into your psyche. Yeah, it's not a good thing. And finally, factions and cults. Children of the Endless Gate. Worshippers of your cast-off brother Inifir, the Children of the Endless Gate, are a splinter sect of the Dendra or Her. They seek to free the spirits of the living from the prisons of their bodies. The children use the blood of their victims to draw the symbol of the Endless Gate. If the gate opens, the cultists hurl their screaming victims into the nightmare beyond. The children pray to the entity within the Endless Gate in the hope that it will calm the turmoil in their own lives, or that it will grant them its power. Church of the Changing God. At least at Sega's Cliffs chapter, venerate the Changing God as a literal deity, a man who has transcended mortality. They view castoffs as facets of his godhood. Its followers study the Changing God's exploits and seek to gain a deeper understanding of his actions so that they can apply his lessons to their lives. He is a symbol of enlightenment and knowledge to them, and they believe that by emulating him, they can heal the ninth world of its ills. Dendra or Her. The Dendra or Her are worshippers of the Lady of Maggots, the great Queen Sarlevan. They are a cult of cannibals devouring flesh to draw the memories of the dead into their own minds. They wear distinctive robes draped with hoses and filters that they use to reduce their meals into an easily digestible slurry. Ugh. Memorialists. The memorialists inhabit the Valley of Dead Heroes, tending the monuments and tombs. They teach that the ninth world is the afterlife, and that the valley contains the graves of every living person on Earth. They claim that if the living of the ninth world find the graves of who they were in life, the ninth world will become a true paradise. Conversely, if more of them forget their true selves, the world will slide into utter chaos. Thus, the memorialists maintain the graves, hoping the world will at last come to its senses. Order of Truth. The Order of Truth stretches far across the Ninth World, though its philosophies and activities differ from place to place. Its primary goal is to use the tools of the Vanished Worlds to help restore humanity to greatness. Those who join the Order are called Aeon Priests, though they are not a religion. Instead, they prize intellect, understanding, and a deep comprehension of the wonders of the ancient world. Across the world, people trust Aeon Priests to handle, identify, and use the Numenera. And finally, Tabat. Before humanity emerged on Earth about 1,000 years ago, the Tabat ruled Greater Garavia. They believed that conflict clarified them, and they thought of themselves as the perfect fighting force. their chain god and enslaved machine intelligence called the Underspine guided them and prophesied their future. They claimed to be the chosen people of New Earth and destroyed any who dared stand against them. That is, until they met the humans at Sega's Cliffs. This defeat led to their ruin when a massive detonation destroyed the Underspine. The Tabat were finished. Only the genocide remains, the last remnant of a forgotten people. Cool. So, that's it. I read it all. Of course, it's going to be updated as we encounter more companions, if there's going to be any more. More characters, locations, creatures, factions, and cults. So, anyway, next episode, we'll ask Adiris to use the mirror caster. So, I have to let her know that when I'm ready, and I'm going to be ready next episode. So thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next one, and enduring, cross strong.